check out this red plum. Here's the inside of it. You're only supposed to take a bite out of each fruit because we're sampling like 50 fruit today, but I can't stop eating this one. It's just so amazing. And I just have to share with you, look at the, again, the differences. Here, over here, pink plums, pretty much like pinkish with, you know, some yellow, you know, yellow color. And then over here, purple plums. We're literally at a candy store. Let's keep on going. You can see they've got guests from Africa, Spain, Australia, and obviously the US. Let's enjoy. So here we are now with Leif Zegers, and the Zegers Farm is a world of wonders and possibilities. And pretty much this is where tomorrow's best fruits are born. And I know that you said the first Zeger fruits were introduced into circulation
way back in 1962. My father originally started breeding azaleas and rhododendrons for the valley for the heat. But then a friend of his introduced him to Fred Anderson, who's the father of the modern day nectarine. And he went to work for Fred for two seasons and decided, you know, fruit was his passion.
Yeah.
And so we kept the nurseries growing and to support his passion of fruit hybridization. And some of the very first trees he used to cross with, because all of our fruit is made from hand pollination. We take the pollen from one tree and put it on the pistil of another tree. But anyway, he rented trees from growers, and he would go out in the springtime in the cold and try to get these trees to pollinate and get some seed from them, because it's the genetic material is the differences in the seeds. It's not in the fruit itself. It's in the embryo that you need to grow and look at the fruit. So. Mm-hmm. And after a lot of that work, he released his first two, was Crimson Gold and
Royal Gold.
Thank you.
And Royal Gold.
That was the start of it from there. And now we have probably more than 400 different patents and varieties of fruit trees, all done with hand pollination.
And another one that you guys are recognized for is also the Pluot. Mm-hmm. Which is a cross between the plum and the apricot, and that's one of the world's favorite fruits as well. Even though I was told in the farm where we got to pick all of these fruits that you see here in front of us and more, how many fruit trees did we, I guess, taste test from today?
Today we looked at 29 different varieties.
And shockingly, my daughter and I ate, I would say, a solid 50% to like the entire fruit from all of those 29 fruit trees. So our bellies are full of fruit. Even though I know when it comes to taste testing, you're only supposed to have a bite, maybe, I guess, is the right way to do it.
It does help to just keep it to a minimum.
But it's kind of like wine tasting. You don't want to drink the whole bottle.
You don't drink 29 bottles of or glasses of wine.
But in the beginning, the first Pluots we released were probably 3/4 plum and 1/4 apricot genetically. But since then, we've been crossing them back and forth, and there are quite a number of mixtures. In fact, some of the plums that Pluots that we looked today have cherry in them.
Oh, wow.
And they're quite genetically diverse.
That's fantastic. I want people to understand, and I want us to hopefully talk about genetics and how it's not GMO. The Santa Rosa plum, which pretty much the world knows by name, was only created by Luther Burbank, which was also a mentor to Floyd Zeger as well. But he invented the Santa Rosa plum in the city of Santa Rosa in 1906. So 100 years ago, there was no Santa Rosa plums.
No.
But now there are, because Luther Burbank took two amazing parents and they fertilized each other through the pollination process, which typically would happen by bees. But what Luther Burbank did, what is happening here at Zeger's, is they're taking the pollen from, you know, a superior, let's say, male tree, and they're pollinating the ovary fruit of the mother tree, and then that seed is the children, just as, you know, my daughter was here to meet, you know, with me today, and she's not a genetic clone of myself.
Nope, she's a hybrid.
She's a hybrid, and that's what's happening here at Zeger's. They're the children of these two amazing parents, and you're crossing them to hopefully create something that's going to be superior to even the mom and dad.
Correct. And, you know, we look for adaptability, because with the changing climate and everything, you have to find varieties that are adaptable to what we get every year.
That's great. Something else we did in the field was the BRICS test. And I know that when it comes to the factors of selecting what is the most superior, amazing fruit, and I'm going to have Tom first give some feedback on it. What are some factors you look for in determining what is the best fruit? And I know there's a difference between another concept you teach is the backyard orchard culture. For the backyard orchard culture, what are they looking for that's different than the commercial grower? And then Leith, if you want to add a little bit more to that.
Well, I mean, the concepts are completely different. You know, a commercial grower is looking for commercial attributes. They want a big piece of fruit. They want a nice exterior color. They want, you know, cleanliness. They don't want bacterial spot or damage on the exterior. They want the fruit to be firm so that it can pack and it can ship and it can display in the markets. They want to be able to cold store it. So commercial attributes and backyard attributes are really two completely different things. Myself as a backyard grower, I'm looking for flavor.
Yeah.
I want it to taste good. And you know what? If it's ugly, I don't really care. If it's small, I'll eat two or three. If it doesn't look exactly the way I want it to look, it's all in flavor for a backyard grower. Of course we want our fruit to look nice and you know, represent a nice large size and a nice uniform quality, but it's not always going to be that way. But for commercial attributes, it has to be that way. That's what they're selling. When you go to the market, you don't take a bite out of it and decide whether you want it.
No.
You look at it and make your decision by a visual contact with that.
So it's the visual that's selling the fruit commercially. Yeah.
But, you know, so one of the things that Zegers has accomplished very effectively over the last six decades is they've combined the two.
That's
great. They're looking for commercial attributes. They're looking for, you know, a firm flavor, firm flesh, a large size, a beautiful exterior color. And they've also made sure that the flavor goes along with it.
So I know other factors in my research that I saw. So we got the taste. Yields, storage, you know, and transportation is important for the commercial grower. That's not necessarily applicable to the backyard orchard.
Mm-hmm.
And then disease resistance, and it's, you know, these factors among others that are being sought after that go behind these amazing fruits that we got to enjoy today.
Correct, because if any one thing is not there in those fruits, it does not make a commercial variety.
That's great. One last thing I want to talk about is BRICS. When we're out in the field, every single fruit we tasted, you know, listening to BRICS, and I heard some BRICS close to 15 and other ones that were close to 25. And I learned that it's not necessarily a high BRICS means a better tasting fruit. And I've noticed that some of the ones that were 15 I thought were amazing. And, you know, I thought a 15 was going to be a bad tasting fruit. What is it behind BRICS and at the end of the day, the taste of the fruit?
BRICS is a measure of the soluble solids in the fruit, which equals how much sugar is in that piece of fruit. A lot of times you can have a piece of fruit with 9 or 10 BRICS. That's one of the best tasting things you ever tasted. But a lot of times the buyers and the markets use BRICS as a determination of whether that fruit's good enough to eat.
Mm-hmm.
They're not usually tasting the fruits. They're saying, I don't want to have any fruit if it doesn't have 14 BRICS, which is fine. It's just, they are missing out on a lot of good eating pieces of fruit, but that is one of the ways that grocery stores and markets measure what fruit they'll
flavor.
Take. And because they assume every higher BRICS means higher flavor.
Yeah, so BRICS is not necessarily correlated to flavor, and that was something that I got to learn today after sampling 29 fruit trees. So that was like highly educational. I thought, oh, I kept on thinking higher BRICS, and every time I heard 24, 25, and I took a bite out of that fruit, I'm like, I tasted something better than that just before this. So
it's not an indication of if it's got good flavor or not. It's just an indication of
it's more sugar.
It's more sugar.
And everybody's taste buds are different. So, you know, the characteristics of a fruit flavor are based on sugar to acid ratios.
Mm-hmm.
So some of the varieties we tasted today, a lot of the white flesh peaches and nectarines, are very low acid, very sub-acid.
Okay.
So you're picking up the emphasis of the sugar in those flavors. Other varieties that we looked at today were more on the acidic side.
Sure.
And everybody has a different opinion of what makes a good piece of fruit.
I
personally like acidic fruit.
Same.
So, you know, I mean, I'm always looking for a good balance or a nice sugar to acid balance.
Yep. But
if it's slightly on the acidic side, I love that. And some people are not really open to that type of a flavor. So yeah, they're always going to be different. And you've got to consider that everything that we tried today, these were all varieties where Leif and the folks here at Zager went out over the last few days and said, okay, we think this is ready. This is at a commercial ripeness right now where you could harvest this commercially and you could take it and run it through the grading and the cold storage and the shipping, and the fruit's still going to hold up. So
yeah,
oftentimes what I would do is come out here and take the list that they looked at today, and I'll look at it in a week or even 2 weeks and go back and review those varieties, and you'll get a completely different complexity to the flavor.
Yeah.
So that's more what
it's good to know.
A backyard grower would be looking for. But in all fairness to a commercial grower, they can't ship a tree ripe piece of fruit. It'd be mush by the time it arrived. So they have to pick something that has consistency and a texture where it can be handled.
One last thing I want to share before we conclude. In regards to creating these trees, hybridization is a process, you know, from the time you hybridize it, you got the seed, you plant the seed, and then you graft it onto mature rootstock, and then you got to wait again the years that it takes. On average, how many seeds, how many new children are being created every year that are then sampled over the course of the next decade in order to determine what is going to be a good fruit that we're going to get to sample today?
Through all the different species, we grow about 50,000 seedlings a year.
Wow.
And we start evaluating those seedlings at second year in the field, and we finish with them in third leaf. If they can't produce a crop and look good by third leaf, they're not worth keeping anyway. So they'll get pulled out, and we will start again with another group of seedlings. But any one of these to become a commercial variety, from the time we do the pollination to the time it becomes a commercial variety, can be 12 to 15 years.
Wow.
So everything that you see here was at least started more than 12 years ago.
That's amazing.
Because when you look at some of this, and I know you can't see that on your video, each one of these is a generation.
I see that.
That's a generation, that was a generation, there's a generation.
Wow.
That this cross was made, and that cross was made, and this cross, and then we grew the seeds, and now we're into the F2 generation. But then this pollen was taken, put on this seed parent, which is probably just as old.
Wow.
So you can see that.
And from 50,000, what's the probability that one's going to make it into
market? Out of 50,000, you might get 2, 3.
Wow. I was thinking 5, but you're saying even less than those 5.
Sometimes, some years we do a good job, and it's 5 or 10. And other years, the climatic conditions and the environmental conditions just didn't hold up to what we needed to see.
That's great. So in conclusion, I just want to share, where can we get these Zager fruit trees?
Zager fruit trees are sold by Dave Wilson Nursery. They have the exclusive rights in the United States to sell to the different markets and the different wholesale markets.
Wonderful.
And they have both a commercial department and a home garden department. And we try to look out for, varieties we think will fit in each one. We work with genetic dwarfs for the home garden market, and some of these commercial varieties, they may not make size, but the flavor is so fantastic that they will be used in the home garden market.
That's wonderful.
So yeah, Zager is the hybridizer. Dave Wilson is the propagator and distributor. So we're wholesale growers of nursery stock to the United States, and we sell, like Leif mentioned, we sell varieties strictly to commercial growers, and then we have a whole division that does nothing but grow varieties for the home garden industry. So
that's
we'll
fantastic.
Sell those to wholesale and retail nurseries, and they're available again then for sale to the public.
So I'm gonna share on our site the davewilson.com website, where you can view those links and all of the dozens and dozens of Zager fruit trees that are made available through the Dave Wilson Nursery. I'm also gonna put the link to the Dave Wilson YouTube channel, where you can get a ton of education from the primary spokesperson being Tom Spellman, who will basically teach you how to care for all of these fruit trees and so much more. So stay tuned for that. And again, I just want to thank you so much for having me.
I'm glad you could come.
And my daughter Isabel earlier today. Thank you so much, Tom.
Thank you.
It's my pleasure.
It's a lot of fun.
All right, great. I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Wonderful.
So here I am now alongside the world famous Floyd Zager of Zager Genetics, and we just toured the hundreds of acres of fruits that he has hybridized for us to enjoy, and is bringing to the world some of the best tasting fruits that tomorrow we'll get to enjoy. And it's an honor and a privilege to be here with you today, and I was hoping I can have you autograph, as we've done with Tom Spellman and other people in the past, if you can just autograph this for our collection here. Floyd is accredited as being the most prolific stone fruit breeder of the modern era. A lot of the fruits, such as the Santa Rosa plum, were only invented about 100 years ago, and a lot of the flavors that you're now eating at the supermarket are attributed thanks to Floyd Zager and the efforts brought to us from Floyd Zager's farm. And thank you so very much. It looks great.
We feel we've been fortunate to work with you.
We truly are. And I've learned from Floyd that the property here is 160 acres, and they go through tens of thousands of trees every year to help select the top few that the world will get to enjoy for the many more years to come. Thank you so very much for having us today. Thank you. And again, here we are with Floyd Zager.
Where did she get that red hair?
Where did you get the red hair from,
Isabel?
It's used from both ends of the fruit because it can change differently on the part of the fruit you're taking it in. And then there is a scale in there. Each side of the fruit, you gotta hold it up. Each side of the fruit can be different because she had a 24 on the other side and this is a 22.
Here. Okay, Ebony Rose Pluot. This has got super high antioxidants with the red flesh. It's been tested and proven that the red flesh pluots have higher in antioxidants, which is better for your health.
And available at?
And available at Dave Wilson Nursery.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Sad-looking tree in the Zager fruit orchard. What happened here?
Well, Charles, this is just an example that even under the most professional of conditions, if you don't thin early and properly, this is the result. You know, there was obviously way too much fruit on the tree. The fruit's big, even though it has been thin, but it just was too much weight load for this tree.
Yeah.
Now, interestingly enough, since this is a new experimental variety, this could have some sort of a genetic disorder where maybe the wood's brittle.
Oh,
so
great
maybe,
point.
Maybe the fruit is good, but maybe now they'll look at this and go, okay, the fruit quality was really good, but the wood was so brittle the tree fell apart. So now let's breed this back with something that's a stronger, structure that can hold this fruit.
That's amazing. I never thought about the brittleness of the wood. I know that typically selection is towards, you know, creating fruit that carry high yields. We're looking for maximum production per square foot on the tree, but that's not always a good thing. As assuming this is a good, strong structured tree, too much fruit also is just not healthy for the tree overall.
Absolutely.
So,
and if it's a variety that they have to go back and thin several times, then it becomes too labor intensive to actually be a good quality marketable fruit.
So also. Too much of a yield could be considered a factor, a negative.
Absolutely. Too much is characteristic. Just as detrimental is not enough.
Interesting. So a great lesson on the importance of thinning your fruit. If you see that the branches are just too heavy with fruit, remove those fruit so that you maintain the structure and the health and the life of your trees for the goal is many decades.
Thinning is something that needs to be done early. And in my personal opinion, it always needs to be done more than once. Most varieties I'll go in and thin two, if not three times. So you want to start when the fruit's about the size of a green pea or a dime.
Okay.
And then look at the tree in another week or 10 days. You might want to go back and thin again. Another week or 10 days, you might want to go back and do it again. So
interesting.
You're just
Couple times a month, you're always examining right. The tree, the overall health, the weight load on the branches, and taking care of it.
Exactly.
Wonderful.
And you'll gain quality and you'll gain size every time you do it.
That's an awesome lesson. Well, let's continue the tour.
A little donut peach.
It would be an actual donut if there was a hole in it.
July 13th maturity date. It's this tree right here. Yellow acid. Way over top. Yellow acid, IS Nickel. July 13th, because it does have a few soft ones in it, but they are, if you get in there, they are.
Yeah, oh, I know.
Sure.
Yeah.
So another helpful tip I just want to share with you is most of the pickers here are picking towards the top of the tree. That's where the optimal sweetness, ripeness that you're going to find within the tree. So check that out as they're reaching within the tree. They're generally going towards the top, picking these fruit. Check this out. I like to wipe off that dust off the fruit. Check out how beautiful the shininess, the color. Let's take a bite. How fantastic is that? Check out the color, sweetness, slight tartness, firm, delicious fruit. So we're leaving here today with two bags of fruit from Zegers Farm that the world has never tasted. So if you've enjoyed this educational video brought to you by iVeganics, be sure to give us a thumbs up. And most importantly, don't forget to hit that subscribe button and the push bell notification to get informed of these videos as soon as they become made available. As always, keep growing with iVeganics and wishing you all happy gardening.